The president's bombshell interview with the British tabloid The Sun is the equivalent of this diplomatic explosion. The president going after the British Prime Minister Theresa May ahead of his big meeting with her, which is happening at this moment behind closed doors. Joining me now is Thomas Newton Dunn. He's the political editor for The Sun who did this interview, who sat down with the president on Wednesday in Brussels, the interview published overnight. Tom, thanks so much for being with us. I really appreciate it. Did you know what you had? Did you walk out of that interview saying, I've got something that is really just going to blow up the president's visit to England?
In short, yes. It was one of those interviews you walk out of, and you desperately try to hide the massive grin that is trying to burst its way onto your face as a horrible journalist, long enough in time to get out and away from the US Embassy in Brussels where we were, before you can then enjoy the moment. It was quite an extraordinary 28 minutes. We had a 10-minute slot with the president. We were about to be ushered out by Sarah Huckabee Sanders, who said our time was up, and then the president said, no, these guys are going to stay for longer. And we kept on going. We kept on asking him questions. He seemed to get quite into it, especially talking about Brexit and, you know, his thoughts on Boris Johnson. We kept the tape rolling. And, we certainly knew what we were getting.
Obviously, British Prime Minister Theresa May's position is so precarious right now, with members of her own cabinet leaving. Did it appear to you that the president knew the difficulties he was causing when he said, look, I told her how to handle Brexit, she wouldn't follow my advice. This means there will be no U.S. trade deal with the U.K. I think Boris Johnson would make a great prime minister. Did he know the trouble he was stirring up?
Yeah. It's difficult to tell. My feeling is he probably didn't, actually, not least because we're hearing rumors that he's going to use the White House lingo, reset his remarks for what he told me a couple of days ago. I think it's difficult to think he really could have. I don't really think the president wants to come here and bring Theresa May a wrapped hand grenade as his welcoming present, which is what he's certainly done. I think he was being honest. I mean, look, you guys know him better than when we do. He talks straight and he answers a straight question most of the time, perhaps not to CNN every now and then, I also hear. But, you know, he is not a normal politician. He's refreshing. Our politicians talk in riddles most of the time when we ask them questions. Now, that is either both very good to your base, because your voters love you if you're being straight and honest and not sound like a normal politician, and obviously a disaster if you're trying to be a diplomat on the world stage.
A wrapped hand grenade. Now, this hand grenade was wrapped on Wednesday. You went to talk to him in Brussels, and we understand that it was embargoed until 11 p.m. last night, England time, British time. And when you look at that, that was supposed to be after dinner, after his big black tie dinner at Blenheim Palace, where the prime minister rolled out the red carpet. Was that timing coincidental? Explain that to me, because a lot of people in the United States look at this and said he wanted to make sure he wasn't wining and dining with her as this interview was coming out.
To be honest, the embargo was our choosing. We carried out the interview in Brussels on Wednesday morning. We said goodbye to the White House press team. We said thank you very much to Sarah and Bill Shine there, and you know, we were very grateful. They didn't ask us when we were using it. I didn't think they thought to. We could have dropped it at any stage from Wednesday lunchtime onwards, I suppose. But obviously, we had a certain football match to be watched here in the UK, or at the World Cup, rather. We were in the semi-finals and we got knocked out, which is a point of intense national embarrassment. So we wanted that to pass, and we wanted to wait till the president arrived so it would have the most relevance. So, no, we chose to run it when we did. We told 10 Downing Street what we had about 6 p.m. yesterday evening, as Marine One was in the air from Washington, from London rather, to Blenheim Palace. So I think Theresa May would have known what was coming her way from the president as he was touching down there for the dinner.
You said goodbye to Sarah Huckabee Sanders, the White House press secretary, and Bill Shine, who is now deputy chief of staff for communications. Bill Shine, everyone knows, in the United States, used to work at Fox News, which is owned by Rupert Murdoch, which also owns The Sun, the British tabloid, where you are the political editor. Was he involved in any way with securing this interview?
I have no idea. I haven't spoken to Rupert Murdoch about this interview. All I know is that I applied for it. I've been speaking to the White House and also the US Embassy here in London for weeks and weeks, trying to persuade them. And the last I heard that we were coming, and it was tremendous news, and we were very grateful for it.
The timing of it, what impact or brushback did you hear as it was coming out overnight? I was in my hotel room. We had wrapped up coverage here. You know, the president was very careful in his public statements about Brexit yesterday. He said out loud, it's up for the people of England to decide. It's not for me to say. So I think it was a surprise to see these words. People close to the White House were saying they were getting text messages. People covering the White House were saying this wasn't exactly perhaps how Sarah Sanders may have described it to the prime minister's office.
Yeah, so I can't really speak for what the White House told number 10. I mean, they're all in the room. Everyone heard every word. As I say, Sarah Huckabee Sanders wanted to stop the interview after about 10 or so minutes because we only had 10 minutes with the president. He had an incredibly busy schedule. He was just about to go off to the NATO summit, and we would have taken our 10 minutes. But, you know, he wanted to let it roll. He wanted to keep on talking. You know, they heard every word. It surprises me, I suppose, if they thought that was going to be not difficult.
Right.
I mean, it's not an unpleasant piece in many respects. You know, he talks about his love for Britain, his love for the Queen. He said nothing negative about Theresa May herself as a person. He said he respected her. But, you know, quite frankly, if you are going to talk about Brexit, which is the Prime Minister's number one policy, remember, if Theresa May gets Brexit wrong here, then she's out of a job, and she's out of a job very quickly indeed. So if you start walking into that sort of territory, I really think that, you know, anyone who's done politics 101 is going to know that's going to cause trouble, as especially when you're arriving and taking up someone's hospitality the next day. We're a bit obsessed with manners over on this side of the pond, as well you know, and it's seen as a tad discourteous to drop that wrapped hand grenade to your guest when your guest has gone out of their way to facilitate such a great show for you. You know, the Blenheim Palace dinner last night, the SAS were rolled out this morning to impress the president. Now, that doesn't happen for many people. So there's a lot of British politicians here today who are very angry with the president, and they're accusing him of showing bad manners.
You say it seems a tad discourteous. That seems a bit like British understatement this morning, Thomas. Let me ask you, because you write that it seemed to you as you were there interviewing the president with Sarah Sanders walking around there, you said it seemed to you like being in the court of a medieval emperor. What do you mean?
I think it was the feeling we got of total power. It took a long time to get into the room where the president was. And remember, we're not used to such an incredible display of might when our world leaders travel around. When Theresa May leaves Chequers, she'll have a Land Rover and her Jaguar, you know, maybe a police motorbike to guide her back to London. But, you know, we travel in a very, very small blueprint. When the president travels, it's a small army. I mean, just watching the Ospreys land with all his support staff here at Chequers was extraordinary. The British Prime Minister doesn't even have her own helicopter, let alone an entire fleet of Ospreys and Black Hawks. So the sheer, you know, the laydown of force and might is always pretty impressive. But I was struck in the room that basically whatever the president says goes. He wasn't contradicted. It didn't strike me that he had anything particular that he was scripted. It was all coming from the heart. And that seems to be, you know, the way he rolls. And, you know, as we've said, there's an advantage to that, and there's a disadvantage to that. I think that's why he is president. It might well be why he stays president and gets re-elected, because he is an extraordinary communicator. No matter what you think of what he communicates, you know, he's known in Britain and the world over for communicating in the way he does. And if you start scripting stuff and he starts being very careful with his words and appears like any other politician, then you know, maybe he won't get elected.
Thomas, you suggested the interview was supposed to be 10 minutes. It did go 28. Did Sarah Sanders try to stop it? Did he actually push her away?
No, it wasn't quite as aggressive as that. She simply was doing her job to say, look, you've had your 10-minute slot. We were told we only had 10 minutes beforehand, and we were very grateful for 10 minutes. But when she said, right, guys, last question, that's when the president said, actually, give these guys a bit more time. And kept on talking and kept on answering our questions. You know, he got quite into the conversation. We were talking about things that interested him, you know, British politics, Brexit, London Mayor Sadiq Khan, who he has had a long ongoing dispute with for 2.5 years now. So you know, he seemed to be quite enjoying it. And, you know, who's any of his staff to tell him not to? If he's the boss after all, isn't he?
He did seem to want to get a lot off his chest and keep on talking to you. Thomas Newton Dunn, thank you for being with us. Congratulations on this interview, which is causing quite a stir, a wrapped hand grenade, as you put it. Thanks so much, Thomas.
Thank you.